You're listening to the Plain Talking UK podcast, a UK-based podcast written by a passenger for anyone. And here are your hosts, Carl Stebbings and Matt Smith.
Well, hello and welcome to episode number 146 of the Plain Talking UK podcast. I'm Carl Stebbings, and not joining me again in the kitchen studio this week, because he's on location in festive land, is Matt Smith.
Festive land, it's Clacton, it's hardly
right, Clacton. It's Clacton. Well, it's on the coast, I think.
As far as the show is concerned, it's like I've literally had the longest holiday ever. I've been away for about 3 weeks, according to the... But anyway, yes, we are. Today, this show is not live. We recorded the intro on Christmas Eve, which was our last live show of 2016. And we've got some very special footage of a very special weekend
Back in July,
Carlos is going to tell you all about now.
Yeah, so we all met up in July this year for the massive Farnborough meetup that we had, where we all got together at the Hogsback Brewery, and we had the Plane Safety Podcast with Pip, we had the APG crew, we had Micah and Brian from the Airplane Geeks, we had the Omega Tau Podcast, me and Matt were there, obviously representing the PTUK team. And we had Nev there. Nev Tech was there as well, doing technical stuff and bits and pieces. And we put together a huge live show that we put out live while we were there at Farnborough. But we also had lots of footage as well, which we took during the show at the air show itself.
The actual air show itself, which
we had some good interviews. We spoke to some really amazing pilots. And we had such a fantastic weekend that weekend at Farnborough. Obviously meeting a lot of people for the first time, including listeners as well of the show who came to Farnborough. And yeah, we've got some really, really great footage to put out. So
yeah, it really was what I can only describe as a truly magical weekend, as all these things usually are. They just go past so fast, don't they? I can't believe it. We were sort of going home so quickly. It was a great weekend.
No, it was all over too quick, unfortunately. And we had a long drive home from that weekend, didn't we, Matt?
Yeah.
Well, actually,
yeah,
I think you drove home.
I did, yes,
yeah,
I did.
Yeah,
I did
you drove home. Yeah. I just sat in the passenger side and watched telly.
Watch the telly, yeah, absolutely. Anyway, it gives me great pleasure to introduce that footage for you now. Enjoy.
Well, good morning, everyone. We are here at the Farnborough International Air Show. It is currently Saturday morning. We've got a big day ahead, quite excited. We've got the big APG meetup that we're being papped as well, I should just say. We've got Mr. Hannington.
Dan Hannington's here.
Again. He's a menace with that camera, I'll tell you. But we've got the big APG meetup that we're looking forward to sort of being involved in tonight. But we've got some special guests here in the show. Thanks, Pip. Pip's throat.
Unfortunately, Pip's
being
here.
Heckled as well. We've got Pip. Al is being unusually well behaved. But But yes. Anyway, where was I?
We're at Farnborough.
Farnborough. That's right. It's Saturday morning. Yeah. It's all in the same thing.
So the sun goes down, and the moon
comes
down.
Up. Yeah. Oh no.
But we've got special guests everywhere, haven't we?
We're
surrounded by famous stars,
yeah,
really.
Absolutely, certainly of the podcast world anyway. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce... I shall introduce our guest to my right, and that is the main man, Micah. Welcome to the show, Micah.
Thank you so much for inviting me to take part in Plain Talking UK. And this has been such a marvelous experience. And what the Plain Talking UK audience needs to know, because we've been talking about it, we've been together for a couple of days now, is we came across the pond to meet people I've never met before, but I've met new old friends, and it's like we've known each other for years. And thank you so much for having me here, and I love Plain Talking UK. I'd love to listen to it whenever I can and participate. And you know what the most important thing is for me to say right now is hello, Myla. These guys, I've already told them hello, and she sends their love, and I hope you're in your pajamas.
Oh, stop it. Honestly, so no, it's very surreal. Last night we had a big meet up at a pub very close to where the hotels were, and it was just very surreal. All the voices that I'm used to hearing in my headphones when I'm scrubbing the floors in my coach to actually have them. It was just weird listening to the conversations going around me. And
for a change, everything was in HD,
yes,
and we
absolutely.
Had no audio
technical
issues.
Problems. No, everything was all streaming beautifully.
Matt, so I need to tell you something, and actually, you need to tell yourself, we're not here. Those voices are in your head. This is all your imagination.
Thanks very much. That's a great help. Thanks. Yeah.
So we also have.
I should be telling that to my psychiatrist later. Thank you. Yeah.
Is that me?
No.
Okay.
No, I can't afford you.
So we've also been very graciously joined here at the show then by Brian Coleman, the associate producer of the Airplane Geeks podcast. So good morning, Brian.
Hi, Carlos. Thanks so much. You guys have been fantastic hosts. So all the things that Mike has said bad about you, absolutely not true. Yeah.
I must say, it's good. It's great to see someone from the Geeks here, Brian, for sure. It's thanks for making the trek all the way here to come and see us this week at Farnborough.
Yep, it's been fantastic. And there's an awful lot of... wow, that was loud. Big metal tubes out there with wings on. So it'll be fun for Matt to introduce him to these things he's been talking about for so long without a clue. Yeah.
Any particular aircraft you're looking forward to seeing this year, Brian?
I really wanted to get inside of the A350, and unfortunately yesterday that took off. So that was kind of sad that it won't be here today. We were able to get on the A380, which was really nice. And as Mike has said, now that he's been on it, they're actually retiring the plane. So yesterday was its last day of flight, and it was a real honor to be one of the last people that was actually on board. There'll probably be maybe another, I don't know, 50, 100 people. So that was kind of fun and special. And to be inside of the A380 with absolutely... no seats, no walls, just cables and test equipment. That was really fun to see.
Oh, great. So I suppose we should go out and see. Oh, yes, Micah.
This intro, if we can, and you can always edit it out if we can't, but we need to get Captain Al and Pilot Pip into the shot.
That's
yeah, let's
point.
Bring those
absolutely.
Guys. Come on, look. Because
absolutely.
There we go.
Dan, you have to come in as well. Come on.
Come on. We bring Dan Hannington as well. Dan,
yeah, absolutely.
Dan, our resident photographer
yeah,
here at the show.
Massive lens. By
massive
way.
Lens. Yeah. Morning, Dan.
Morning, everyone.
Captain Al, a little word from you.
That'll do.
And from you, Pip.
Good morning, everyone.
Very good morning from a beautiful sunny Farnborough.
Well, anyway, should we go and have some fun?
Yeah, we're here for a reason. So obviously, what we're going to do in this little segment today is, as everybody knows, the running joke is basically, I'm a coach driver by trade, and I do literally know virtually nothing about aircraft. And I can't think of two people greater in this world to walk me through some of the static displays here at Farnborough.
Show up.
Right.
Yeah, just waiting for you.
I'm now off.
Yeah, you're now off. Yeah. So, basically, that's what we're going to do. And we're going to start with the aircraft that's right behind me.
Right now, we're standing in front of the engine, the Rolls-Royce engine, from the F-35B. And this engine is unbelievable because it's not just a turbofan, and I hope I have that right, Max, but it's also a turboshaft because the turbofan powers a vertical jet or fan for vertical lift. And if you look at it, you'd think there are two engines. It's really only one engine with the fan and the prop, and we're right in front of it. This is the first aircraft, Matt, to ever take off vertically. It's the F-35B. There are three different models of the F-35. It's the first aircraft to be able to take off vertically, fly supersonically with reheaters, and then land vertically. It's still, some of them are in service, the F-35, the B model, and I hope I have that right, and David, if I don't, I'm sure you'll correct me, and hope and expect you to. The B model is with the Marines. The vertical takeoff and landing one is with the Marines. There's also the C model, and I believe the C model is for the Navy. Is that right, Brian?
Sure.
Say it with confidence, people believe you. I have no idea.
And designed for carrier landings, and the A model, and I may have the A and the C confused, is for the Air Force, designed for landings on regular runways. It's a brand new aircraft, still working out some bugs, but it's they call it an F, it's really an A for an attack aircraft, designed for close air support. Not as much air to air, but it certainly can do air to air.
And just out of it, I mean, I mean, I'm familiar with vertical takeoffs because I know the Harrier, I think, here in the UK was obviously quite a big plane for that sort of thing. In fact, as I say, I've mentioned on our show before, watched one drop into the sea at Lowestoft when they were doing an air show a few years back. But so how does that differ to this particular configuration?
The Harrier had, actually outlets that move up and down and have its vertical thing. While the tail engine or the tail cone of the F-35 rotates up and down, it has a center fan that's located right behind the pilot. And the Harrier could not fly supersonically. This is the first aircraft that could fly supersonic. And supersonic is about 700 Mach 1 or more, and I believe it starts at sea level about 750 miles per hour.
So we've moved to a different aircraft now, and we are standing in front of...
This is the FA-18 Super Hornet. Now, there are two things that are important about what I just said. A lot of people refer to the F-18, and they say F-18 Hornet. That's a different airplane. Right. The F-18 is a predecessor of the Super Hornet, they were both FA-18, so I'll get to that in a moment. But the Hornet was a predecessor of the Super Hornet. The Super Hornet is practically a completely different aircraft, but they still call it the Hornet. One of the big secrets that I learned from our Professor Vanderhoof about how to tell the difference between a Hornet and a Super Hornet, the easiest way for me, is the shape of the air intake right behind me. And if you're looking behind me, and I'm going to turn a little bit for the camera, you can see the red air intake, and you can see that it's square. That means it's a Super Hornet. The older Hornets, the original Hornets, the air intake was round. And whenever I'm watching TV and I'm looking at the aircraft and I see a Hornet, that's how I can tell. There are dozens of other ways that Professor Vanderhoof could tell you about, but that's how I can tell the difference between a Super Hornet and a Hornet. The other thing, this is a carrier-based aircraft. It's for the Navy and the Marines, and they fly it. This is the aircraft that the F-35 is going to replace. So it's an older aircraft, but the F-35, they're not able to roll them out quite as fast as they had hoped. So they're actually taking FA-18s out of the boneyard, reconditioning them, and putting them back into service in order to fill the mission role that we need to serve until we can really get enough F-35s up and flying. And the other thing I said in the beginning was I said it's an FA-18. F stands for fighter, A stands for attack. When you talk about an F-16, that's a fighter. That does do ground support, but it's predominantly for air-to-air combat. The A is for attack and for ground attack. And again, I may infuriate our good friend, David Vanderhoof, like the A-10. The A-10 is an attack aircraft designed for ground attack. The FA-18 is fighter and attack and designed to be able to do both. Air-to-air combat as well as ground attack. And from what I... This is also the aircraft that our good friend Captain Nick flew after the F-4.
And it's all coming full circle, right? Yeah.
So this is one reason why this aircraft is so important to me, because Captain Nick, our very close friend and one of the organizers of this event, has a near and dear relationship with it. And he can tell you much more about it. And our good friend Marcus from the Omega Tau podcast interviewed him about flying the F-18 and also the F-4, which was the predecessor to that. And so it's very wonderful to be so close to it.
One of the other things that's different about the Hornet and Super Hornet is the size. The Super Hornet, I can't remember in feet how much larger it is, but it's significantly larger. So if they were side by side, you would definitely know that they were two different aircraft.
We're here speaking with Lieutenant Jeff Hoagie Hanley from the U.S. Navy, who flies this beautiful FA-18. You've been flying it for some time now, haven't you?
4 or 5 years.
What do you like about it?
Just an airplane that can do so many different missions and so many different things, that the variety of training and opportunities that we have flying this airplane just make it an absolute blast. And also this airplane just does what you want it to do. It's fantastic.
Now, one of the things about this aircraft, it's used by a number of different nations, and our friend flew the FA-18 for the Royal Air Force, but you're a naval aviator. That's a completely different thing. You're not a pilot, you're an aviator. So you have to trap. Can you tell us a little bit about what a trap is and what that means and how you come down on a carrier?
Well, landing on the aircraft carrier is essentially taking a trap, is another term for it. So basically taking 44-ish thousand pounds of steel and bringing it to a stop in about 200 feet of cable draw out there in about 2 or 3 seconds. So it's about 150 to zero. So it's pretty fun landing on the ship. I mean, it is what makes us naval aviators, just like you said. And it's the amount of training that we get to the point where you can do it is essentially it's what it takes. It takes lots and lots and lots of practice, lots of training.
And what's important for our audience to know is it's not just a short runway where you're laying down a hook to trap a cable to get caught on that, but it's also a runway that you're not necessarily sure where it's going to be, and it's rolling from side to side and up and down all at the same time. So naval aviators are truly amazing pilots, and I'm not sure how well our audience knows that, and they need to know that, and our good friend Matt needs to know that too. A naval aviator is completely different from an Air Force pilot. Now, you do this day or night, any weather. How long does it take to learn to catch a line?
Well, you spend about a year in Kingsville Meridian, basically a Texas or Mississippi, doing it in a modified Hawk, a Goshawk, a T-45. You do hundreds and hundreds of practice landings in the field, and on the airfield and the runway, they have a painted carrier box with the appropriate, you know, instrumentation to kind of show you exactly what it would look like. So the first time you roll into the groove on a carrier, it looks very, very familiar, and you're going to have lots of practice. The muscle memory is all going to be there. And after you do that, you get qualified in that airplane, and then you'll get qualified in this airplane after you go through a full tactical syllabus. So it takes a while. It takes a couple of years, lots of practice landings. LSO, the paddles are going to help you out. The guys that are on the ground or on the ship helping you get on deck, they're going to give you lots of sugar and give you some love to get you on deck the first time. It's definitely definitely happy to have they call them angels in white, the guys in the white coats out there helping you out.
Are you getting any special training or program set up to transition to the F-35, or are you going to be with the FA-18 for the rest of your career?
I have no idea where the rest of the career is going to go. It's really just a matter of how quickly things come on board. The RAG is, or the Fleet Replacement Squadron for the F-35 is obviously stood up down in Eglin, VFA-101, and they're working really hard. They're moving forward very quickly. It's just a matter of when it happens and the timing and where I end up. But the F-18, particularly the Super Hornet, is going to be around for a very long time. So if somebody wants to stay F-18s, hopefully they continue to do that. If they want to do that, if they want to transition to the F-35. The two very different airplanes. I'm really anxious to see what it's able to do and how it's able to contribute to the carrier strike group and the air wings out there in the real world. I'm really curious to see how it all turns out. But it's exciting times. New airplanes, transitioning to different kind of models of how we're employing these things overall as far as an air wing strike group perspective is concerned.
One more carrier question, and Matt, you can probably edit this around or at least take this part out, but maybe move it around in here. When you're coming in onto a carrier, at least especially at first, your heart is usually in your mouth and there could be all sorts of things in other places. But I understand that feeling can be a little frightening, especially at first, even though you're well-trained. It's always, you never know what's going to happen. But I understand the takeoff is one of the most thrilling and most amazing experiences that anybody could have, and one that I've always wanted to try. Can you describe what a carrier takeoff is like at an FA-18?
Daytime cat shot doesn't get much better than that. It's about 0 to 150, 170 miles an hour, depending on how heavy you are. It has to get you to a certain end speed. The heavier you are, the faster you got to go. So especially if it's some sort of asymmetric loadout, it's a pretty good little jolt. It's a lot of fun. And the interesting part about it is that when you have your throttles all the way up, your flight controls are all the way up, you're ready to go, you give them the signal that you're ready to go, it's still a solid 4 or 5 seconds before they actually launch you off, and you don't know when it's going to happen. So it's always a little bit of a surprise, which is kind of fun. Nighttime is absolutely terrifying, I will tell you that, especially if there's no moon, no stars, you have no horizon. So you're essentially launching into a milky black abyss, which is definitely a little spooky, but daytime, it can't beat it. It's a lot of fun.
And the pitch and roll must be interesting as well. So just like on landings, you have to pay special attention to that on takeoff as well?
They'll time it. If the deck's pitching up and down, they will time the shot so that we'll launch you off essentially when the deck is all the way up. And they're pretty good about timing that, absolutely right. It's kind of important, obviously. For the pitch and roll, it's something you get accustomed to. They have different ways of guiding you to the appropriate place to land depending on how much the deck is pitching. I think the worst pitching deck we saw was off like the Azores, in like the open water, essentially the Atlantic Ocean. That's where it gets a little more compared to, in Gulf or sort of littoral regions where it's a little smoother. It can definitely get a little spooky out there.
So a bit about your career. How did your sort of aviation career begin for you?
Well, I started flying Cessnas and Piper Cubs.
Same as me.
Just fell in love with it right away. Always had a lot of interest in aviation, even from like when I was a little kid. But my friends are, take a lesson in a Cessna and just kind of be in love with it. So I got some a little bit of just private pilot type stuff when I was in college, and then I did not do any academy or ROTC. I just off the street graduated college, said I'll go to OCS and roll the dice and see what happens, and I was lucky enough to just be lucky at every wicket to where I ended up exactly where I wanted to be, which is flying a Super Hornet. So you know, naval aviation is all about timing. I got very lucky every time that timing came up. So I'm just fortunate to that they still let me do this, and hopefully they'll let me do it for as long as I can. So,
do you still have time when you're at home to do a bit of sort of recreational flying?
Oh, sure. Every now and then, I flew the wife and I out to, you know, just different locations. You know, if we had the time. Obviously, it's a little expensive for me, so I don't do it very often. But every now and then. For instance, my wife's birthday, after we got married, first thing we did was take her up flying, just kind of a birthday present to see how she enjoyed it. She was obviously terrified, but it was because it's different when you actually see the person at the controls, I think. She's growing to like it a lot as well. Just general aviation's a lot of fun. Different world, obviously, what we do out here. Very missionized, obviously. Everything that we do is for a mission reason, but it is nice to just take off and kind of bomb around in a prop plane every now and then. It's a good time, so definitely enjoy it.
It's one of the last questions I was going to ask. We always ask all the pilots who interview for the show, and it's a question that sometimes catches people out. But given the chance to fly any aircraft in the world, either retired or still flying, anything at all, what would be your choice aircraft to have a go in?
Oh boy, you're opening up so many cans of worms with this, all the community rivalries and all that stuff. So I got to be real careful.
It doesn't have to be current, okay?
Yeah, that's true. I spent my entire career trying to get in this airplane. And so that has been my goal the entire time since I got into the business. So I think during that time I would have told you, yeah, I want to get into this airplane, obviously, because I really enjoy it. This airplane allows you to do so many different things. You air-to-air, air-to-ground, everything. You know, landing on the boat, taking off from the boat, it does it all. So I've been very happy to get into this airplane. I think historically, I think it'd be cool to get into some of like the first jet airplanes. I think they're always fascinated by, you know, things like Banshees, stuff like that. The original jets that flew and landed and took off from aircraft carriers. That would be a really neat thing to see. And just how terrifying a straight deck carrier probably was. And I have friends, obviously a fair amount senior to me, that had done some straight deck landings and stuff like that. And it'd be cool to see that. I will never have the chance, but historically, yeah, kind of the first jets that took off and landed from aircraft carriers, I'd like to see that. So,
Lieutenant Hanley, Hoagie, thank you very, very much for being a part of this.
No, of course.
So we've moved aircraft again. We are now in front of the F-18.
No, we were in front of the FA-18, right. And now we're in front of an F-16. The F-16 is known as the Fighting Falcon. But what's the interesting thing about it being known as a Fighting Falcon, which is its name, as the FA-18 is a Super Hornet, although it's known and was designated the Fighting Falcon, those who fly it call it the Viper. Now, you took a look at it, and you can see there's one to our right that's not in the shot. Why do you suppose it might be called the Viper? Any idea? Look at the way the canopy overhangs the engine. Right. It looks like a snake ready to bite.
Yeah.
And so this is really the pilots who fly this call it the F-16 Viper. The F-16, notice it's an F as opposed to an FA. It's a fighter. It's air-to-air. Now, it can do some ground support, but it's air-to-air. It's a single-engine aircraft, where the F-18 is a twin-engine aircraft and a carrier-based aircraft. This is the Air Force, land-based aircraft. But it's a real interesting thing about how it developed is the fact that there was a fly-off between the YF-16 and the YF-17. The YF and the F-16-1, and then the U.S. Air Force picked the F-16. But the YF-17 was an incredible bird, an amazing plane, and it was very, very close, side by side. So after they picked the F-16, the Navy looked at the YF-17 and said, maybe we should do something with it. And from the YF-17 came the FA-18. And it's really, there are big differences, but if you were to see the fly-off, you'd say, oh, that's an F-18 flying off against the F-16. Now, the F-16 flies for the Air Force Thunderbirds.
Right.
The FA-18 flies for the Navy Blue Angels. And they're both amazing aircraft. But I learned this from our good friend David Vanderhoof. I only just learned this recently. The Air Force flies F-16s that could be taken out of the Thunderbirds and go into service at any time, ready to go. All they got to do is load them up with ammunition. But the Navy gets the oldest F-18s flying around. The oldest and the most decrepit, ready to go to the boneyard aircraft, but they keep them flying and flying perfectly. if anybody sees a demonstration of the Navy F-18 Blue Angels, it's an unbelievable demonstration in aircraft that are ready to be retired.
So why should I be really excited about this particular aircraft? Why should I be so excited about the 16 here? What's so special?
The F-16, also a single engine aircraft, like we said before. The engine that's in there is the same engine as in the F-15, but the F-15 has two of them. Okay, and it was designed like that so that they can switch out engines pretty much as needed. I guess the reason to be excited is because it's fast, it's beautiful, and look at it. Have you ever seen anything that looked deadlier?
Okay, we've moved to another part of the airfield now, and I have a Micah who's standing to my left at the moment. He's rather excited about where we're standing right now. So, we are standing in front of...
It's the PBY-5A Catalina, built in 1943. Her name is Miss Pickup, which we'll learn about why a moment from Captain Rod. But when you see her, you'll understand that she's a personal friend, Miss Pickup herself, of Captain Nick.
Really, I don't know if I dare ask why. But tell us a little bit about the aircraft. What role does it serve at the moment?
I reckon it's actually one of the first multi-role combat aircraft there were during the war, because it's for air sea rescue, long range surveillance, and light attack, because they used to put torpedoes, depth charges, bombs, whatever under the wings. They did sink quite a few U-boats during the war.
Yeah, this is definitely one of my most favorite aircraft, so quite happy to be here and standing next to her.
Okay, and I have to ask the question, why? What is it? Why should I, as the novice here, be so excited about this aircraft?
Yeah, I think really because of its mission during World War II, the air-sea rescue. My grandfather was in the Coast Guard, and just the valuable contribution that it made to the war, and being a spotter, and of course being the search and rescue aircraft. Yeah, really, really contributed a lot.
And the other thing that you need to know about, this is also my favorite aircraft. And it's one of my favorite aircraft. I have many favorite aircraft. But I did a piece for the Airplane Geeks several years ago about a restoration of one taking place in Sanford. And it's one of my favorite aircraft because I call it the DC-3 of the sea. Because the DC-3 could do anything, and it could fly forever. And it had R-1800 engines, the same engines as a PBY-5A does. But the PBY-5A not only did it from the sea. Do you remember how we talked about the difference between an Air Force pilot and a naval aviator? The PBY does everything a DC-3 does, but can do it in water.
Wow. Wow. So this can land on the water, can it?
Yes, we still do when we can. Yes. Not often enough.
No.
We much prefer fresh water, so find a nice big lake, and we're quite happy to go and splash around in it for a few days.
Water, that's landing on water on purpose.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Not
a crash landing.
No.
And so let me ask you a little bit about flying the PBY, and a bit about type ratings and what it's like to take off and land in the water with such a huge... I mean, this is a big, big airplane. It's not a little float plane. How did you become... A type rated in a PBY, and how long have you been flying her?
The actual conversion, as long as you're used to flying something else, apart from perhaps the size, which does take a bit of getting used to, then it's a fairly straightforward twin engine conversion from any other source. Even if you're only a single engine pilot, you gradually get a twin rating and all the rest of it, but it's just as well to have a twin rating before you start. But it's quite different from a lot of other aircraft. It will not settle down and fly itself. You have to fly it all the way. You can't take your hands off. There's no autopilot in there. And it waddles around the sky all over the place. So it needs a lot of work to actually fly it. Once you've got the hang of it on the land, then being on the water, that's another steep learning curve. Getting it on the water is... The only advantage you have on water, if you've got a big enough lake, is you're always going to land into wind. That's the whole idea of it, to make it easy. But once you're on the water, it gets even harder, because unlike a float plane, we haven't got any water rudders. There's no brakes on the water.
And the engines are fairly close together as well.
So all we've got is bootfuls of rudder either way, a lot of power on one side or the other. And if you try taxiing downwind, well, that's almost impossible. You just get a few degrees off and you finish up doing a circle and carrying on again. But, it's a lot to learn. It's never ending, really.
One of the things that I'd heard is that during World War II, when the aircraft would be fully loaded, I mean, and very, very heavy, and taking off from a flat surface, that it might go take up miles of space before you could get her up on into the air. Could you talk about what it's like to take off with all that drag?
Well, I mean, in what we don't really like is a glassy surface, because there's a huge amount of suction on the hull, both when you're landing and trying to take off. Because when you're landing, it'll just grab the hull and try to pull you down, which is why you have the little step in the fuselage just behind the wheels there, trying to break up the suction.
And those wonderful engine noises are coming from a 737 taking off.
And similarly, when you're trying on the water, trying to take off, you've got to break the suction to get it off. So we do like at least some disturbance on the water. During the war, they could actually land on extremely heavy seas going right out the other extreme from a glassy water. But we limited ourselves to about two foot waves if we can. But we're not very happy. So.
Now, her name is Miss Pickup, and there's a special reason for that name. Tell us about what kind of air-sea rescue the PBY did in World War II.
It actually goes with the colour scheme that we'd chosen. There were two squadrons of what were termed OA-10As of the United States Army Air Force, based at Halesworth in East Anglia.
Ironically, that's where we're from.
You know about exactly where it is then. And this is, apart from the fact we've got a gloss finish, they had matte white, but otherwise it's accurate in every respect. We thought for a long time that the one without the tail number that this one represents, there's another story about that, but we thought it was Sophisticat, because they all had their own little things. Every aircraft had something different. But on a particular mission, we thought it was a particular crew with their own aeroplane, but it turned out the crew was right, but the aeroplane they borrowed from one of the other groups, because the one they normally flew was US, and that turned out to be Miss Pickup. That actually came from the guys in the museum at Halesworth.
Oh, wow.
They've actually found out all this about it. Yeah,
I have to say,
it has its double meaning, because they have their saucy nose art. You look at the Sally B. It's even worse than this one.
This one's wearing clothes, which is refreshing for a family show.
Because of the air sea rescue capability, then it can pick people up out of the water. So that's why they chose that one, obviously.
And the PBY rescued many flyers, many flyers, because it could again do anything. And Matt, what I wanted to say, the other thing, why should you be excited about this plane? Just look at her. She's beautiful. Max Flight once said a DC-3 is the way an airplane ought to look. Well, it's true, but a PBY is what an airplane should look like. It's a gorgeous craft with beautiful lines, and even if Miss Pickup wasn't on her, I would still love her.
Now, I'm just going to ask the question, as I said, just turn over there. We've got the pods on the back there. What were they for during World War II?
Well, those blisters, as we call them, for obvious reason, are actual modern replacements from the originals.
Yeah.
Obviously, going back during the war, they didn't know how to produce plexiglass things like that, I don't think. No. Anyway, they wouldn't last very long. So they had some heavily framed affairs where the front bit was fixed, the back bit was fixed, and the bit in the middle used to rotate inboard. And just inside there, they had 50 calibre machine guns mounted. So when it was fully open, there's a big field of fire for the guys to man their machine guns. And I mean, it's a very slow aeroplane, so it was very easily attacked in the warp. So, they needed all the weaponry they could get. There used to be a gun turret on the nose as well, just in front of the cockpit. That had a single, double guns, whichever model they happened to be. And there used to be, where our air stair goes up now at the back, there used to be a fixed gun facing backwards as well.
It had a bit of firepower.
Wow.
And the blister itself, when you look at it, right now it's one big bubble, but they would open like an eyelid. You would reach around and open it up, and that's where the 50 calibers would fire from, but also be where we'd pick up from the sea from. And the other interesting thing about those particular blisters is on the original B-17B, I believe, they used the same blisters before they came up with different kinds of turrets in the side. And you would, if you look at that original aircraft, if you ever watch the 1941 film Air Force, where you see that, you'll see those blisters.
Now, before we wrap up, because I know you've got to get this out in the air very, very soon. Okay. Before we wrap up, we always ask all our pilots on the Plane Talking UK show one question. Obviously, you love this aircraft more than anything else in the world. But if you could pick any aircraft in history, is there an aircraft that you would have always loved to have basically sat behind the controls of and just taken out for a joyride?
Well, I was going to say Concorde, but I don't think they take it for a job. Yeah, I was a little bit unfortunate. I never actually got to fly in a Concorde or anything like that. But
That's a popular choice with a lot of people. Everybody has a real love of the Concorde.
It has to be. How well I would have fitted in it, because I would have to crouch all the way up the fuselage, to get anywhere near the front. So, let alone sit at a window seat or.
Yeah. Anyway, Rob, thank you very much for your time, and thanks for telling us a little bit about the aircraft.
All right, we're in Carlos's TriStar van, and Matt, say hello.
Hello.
Okay, I'm not sure you could hear that, but he's in the back of this van, and we have just left the air show, and we are heading over to the Hog's Back Inn, where we're going to start the setup for this afternoon/evening's live event. So this is exciting. Really looking forward to it. Well, what we have here, ladies and gentlemen, is the setup, the roadies crew setting up the audio and visual, and there's Carlos's best side right there. There we go. Say hi, Carlos.
Hi, Carlos.
And Mrs. Nev. Nev.
Hi, Jeff. Hi.
And he's taking care of all the amazing audio. Look at this. Look at this audio.
Hold on. Yeah, cool.
Isn't that amazing? Wow, and look at all this equipment that Carlos has brought with him. Amazing stuff. So, in about 2.5 hours, we should be live. Now, okay. Matt is out here with the satellite dish set up. Say hi, Matt. Ryan. There we go. Part of the satellite crew. All right.
Right, everyone, welcome to the APG Farnborough 2006 show. I'm Carlos, as some of you may know. 2016.
Start over.
It's my English accent. It throws all the American guys, you see.
Hi, guys, I'm Owen. Come from Ireland, but I'm living just down the road. This show, I've been waiting for it for a long time. Glad I got the days off. Yeah, can't wait to meet with all the community. Be a fantastic show.
Hi, James Plumridge, originally from South Africa, now living in England. Out to come see the guys at the podcast today. Been enjoying the Farnborough Air Show today, out in the lovely sunshine, as you can see. Good to meet everyone. Looking forward to the show. Looking forward to some good beers. So.
Hi, my name is Sjoerd Bakker from the Netherlands. I've been following the podcast for, say, 6 months of the airplane geeks, and 1 year and a half of Plane Talking UK and the airline pilot guy and the Pips show, and it's a nice opportunity to meet everyone, the teams and also the communities. I'm having a lot of fun, and thanks to everyone who made this happening possible with their time and energy. And well, you guys know who you are. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Tillman. I'm from Berlin, Germany. I'm a private pilot, and I came over for the air show and for the meetup. And I'm really happy about the occasion of a European meetup. And I'm really happy about the occasion to meet the guys that I feel I know already, and it's a really cool community here.
All is well so far, but the night is young, and there's plenty that can go wrong. So, but we've got a lot of kit here, and we're hoping it's going to be a great show.
Yeah, okay, yeah, cool.
Where are we? It's now approaching 20:05, so we're 20 minutes before, hopefully, our broadcast is going to go live. We think everything's okay, ready to go. We've got some impressive speed test. The guy behind the camera has been helping out massively, Ryan, haven't you? But we're all ready to go. We've done speed tests. Satellite's all ready for as a backup. It's just we're ready to go. I think we need to do it. Let's do it.
All right, airline pilot guy, Farnborough, 2016. Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show. I'm Captain Jeff, and I'm here with all my friends, including those up here with me on the panel and everybody here in the room, the ballroom today. Big hand. I'm going to end the show. I'm going to say the show is over. Wishing you clear skies, unlimited visibility, and tailwinds. Take care. And God bless.
Woohoo!
This and other great shows at the Aviation Media Network.
The Voices in Your Head.com.
Aviation media has long been the domain of the newspapers and magazines.
Well, not anymore. I'm Steve Vischer.
And I'm Grant McCarran, and we're bringing aviation right into your radio.
Yes, we're making aviation cool and interesting for everyone.
Hang on, aviation's always been cool. Check this out.
How cool is this?
Grant, turn that down. Here at Plane Crazy Down Under, we've got pilots, engineers, air traffic controllers, industry leaders, even politicians dropping by to talk to us about the amazing world of aviation right here in Australia and occasionally in New Zealand as well.
Wow, that's cooler than I thought, mate.
Find us at planecrazydownunder.com, on iTunes, or lurking about on other people's podcasts just like this one.
We've got crazy accents and lots of great aviation content.
And we promise not to talk about the cricket.
No, never, not the cricket.
Quack, 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 quack.
What is cricket anyhow?
Something we win a lot. Oh, there
we go.
The Plane Talking UK podcast is a voluntary project that aims to keep you informed with the latest aviation-related stories from newswires across the globe.
Producing our content does cost money, though. If you enjoy our show, why not help us keep on the air by making a donation towards the server and website hosting fees through PayPal? Any contributions would be greatly appreciated.
Are you an Amazon user? If so, why not do your shopping through the link on our website? There's no cost to yourself, and Amazon pay us a small referral fee on qualifying purchases.
To find out more about the show and to meet the team, take yourself to our website, www.plaintalkinguk.com,
or find us on Facebook at facebook.com/plaintalkinguk, on Twitter via @plaintalkinguk, or get in touch via email on podcast@plaintalkinguk.com.
Thanks for listening.
Okay, so we're here at Farnborough. We're now about to watch the A380. Basically, it's I think the best way to describe it is a demonstrator. Is that right, Cap Nal?
Absolutely, yes. It's just showing you the versatility and manoeuvrability of what is a very large aeroplane.
Yeah. Now, we actually watched it yesterday doing its stuff, and as I was saying in the podcast that we did at the show itself, it completely blew me away with its agility. And as I say, Cap Nal just going to talk me through essentially. It's just because it looks like it's in a permanent stall. Even there, it doesn't look like it got anywhere near fast enough to get off the ground.
Well, what you have here at Farnborough is you have an aeroplane. It's an empty aeroplane, so it probably weighs around about 200 tons. That's metric tons. That's the proper tons, not those silly tons that the Americans use. But those wings were designed to carry a maximum all-up weight of around about 900 tons in its cargo configuration. Wow. So it's got an 80-meter wingspan or thereabouts. So because it's very light, it is able to fly very slowly because, of course, the wings are producing all of the lift combined with the slats and flaps. But it's light, so it can fly very slow, which allows it to have a very small radius of turn, because of course the faster you fly, the bigger the radius of turn that you have, unless you increase the angle bank. Now this is a commercial airliner, it's fly-by-wire, so the maximum bank angle that they are using for this demonstration is 67 degrees. So it's, you know, it's not the F-35, it's not rolling inverted or anything, because this is an aeroplane designed to carry hundreds of people. But because it's light and it's got those fantastic engines and those beautiful wings, it is just so graceful for a large aeroplane in the sky. And I think that's possibly one of the things that really caught your eye when you saw it yesterday.
Yeah, absolutely. As I said, it just didn't look like it was flying anywhere near fast enough. It just completely blew me away yesterday.
Well, yeah, because we're so used to seeing airliners, you know, sort of taking off fully loaded with passengers, bags, cargo, etc. So the heavier the aircraft is, the faster it has to fly. And of course, when we're going from A to B in an airliner, we're not doing circles around the airfield as the A380 is demonstrating. But we're just seeing what is fundamentally a large aeroplane being very graceful in how it manoeuvres around the Farnborough sky here. And it is fair to say that even though the A380 has been flying now for quite a reasonable period of time, it catches the attention of the public here. There are a lot of people watching it. Yes, it may not have the dazzle factor of the F-35, but it is just flying beautifully slow and giving everybody a real opportunity to see, you know, a real combination of British engineering and European engineering at its finest. And I say British because those awesome wings are produced in the United Kingdom up at Broughton, just on the Welsh-English border.
I mean, surely that can't be far away from a stall at the speed it's flying at.
No, there's still quite a large margin between where the stall in effect would occur. Remember, it's an Airbus, so it's fly-by-wire, so you have all of the flight envelope protections. So with normal law being used, the aeroplane, in essence, is protected from stalling by the flight control computers, which allows the pilots really to manoeuvre it at the lower speed that the computers will allow it to fly at. And that's still significantly above the stall.
I just got this image in my head of, like, if you're in that cockpit, all I hear is, pull up!
No, there'll be none of that. This is just a light aeroplane designed to carry a much greater amount of load. So it's just going about pretty normal things, but just because of its size and the fact that it can fly slowly, it's just a crowd, captivator. Okay, so here goes the A400M, the military transport aircraft. Now this is a different performance. Matt's got the video rolling here of the A380 coming into land. So the 400 gets airborne as the 380 comes into land, and because of as I've mentioned now, though, those great big wings and the lightweight of the aeroplane here today. And let's be honest, Farnborough's runway is not the same length as somewhere like Heathrow or Singapore, but it just is just going to stop on a sixpence today, and it represents a true feat of sort of engineering, really, that the way that the aeroplane can just come in with.
So obviously the A400M is like the military.
Yes, I mean the 400 is a military transport aircraft. So now we're not operating in the same sort of regime. So the aeroplane's able to manoeuvre in a much more acute fashion. So it's allowed to use much more in the way of bank, and still it's quite a reasonable size aeroplane. But it's not limited to 67 degrees of bank in the way that its commercial cousins are. So one of the reasons that is, of course, it's a military aeroplane. So if you imagine taking off from somewhere that's hostile, you might need to evade hostile fire. So the ability to just sort of maneuver the aeroplane quite vigorously. But it's an Airbus and it has flight envelope protections with just different parameters set for it.
So obviously, as I say, the 400M obviously is prop over the,
yes,
the jet.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, I made a bit of a what turned out to be a foolish comment really yesterday, was the fact you always, when you see it, for some reason, me, the novice, sort of sees the prop plane and sort of thinks sort of maybe older technology and all that kind of thing. So why are they, what does the prop give that makes people sort of still use it over the jet engine for certain activities?
Well, one of the reasons that many people see propeller driven aeroplanes as sort of like old fashioned, if you like, is that they think of petrol driven piston engines turning propellers of times gone by and sort of general aviation. But we're actually looking at a turboprop, so we have effectively jet engines that are using propellers, right, as their propulsion. And if you look at
using propellers rather than the turbine, essentially.
Well, it's still the turbine, but if you look at a jet engine, you'll see a fan at the front.
Right.
Well, that's really just an enclosed propeller.
Yeah, true.
A few more blades. So it's just a slightly different design, but the technology is remarkably similar, really. You have, a propeller in the form of a fan, or on a turboprop, a much more sort of visible propeller with less blades. And there are many different reasons why manufacturers go this way. But typically, if you look at an airliner, it's going to fly very high, reasonably fast, long distances. Military transport aeroplane required to get off, maybe unprepared surfaces, so grass or gravel. Typically flying lower, and shorter distances. So that's just the sort of the design criteria that people look for. Jet engines are quite critical with regards to ingesting sort of foreign objects,
right.
So birds, yeah. Stones, that
Lovely.
Sort of thing. Whereas with a propeller aircraft, they're able to sort of bounce them off
right.
much more.
Yeah,
so
yeah. Sort of chop it up,
yeah. So in some ways, you're kind of looking at the sort of equivalent of a 4x4,
right.
more so than a coach.
Yeah, built for comfort, not speed, essentially.
Just an entirely different role.
Yeah. Okay. So presumably prop is more commonplace in sort of military, perhaps, certainly for transporters and things like that.
Yes, I mean if you sort of...
I mean not the fighter jets.
No, absolutely. But if we sort of continue the sort of vehicle analogy, if you look at your sort of your Land Rover, your Range Rover,
yeah.
in that rugged environment,
yeah.
well, you're not going to take your coach into that environment,
no.
are you?
No, no.
Your coach isn't designed... To go off road.
No. And it does sometimes, but
yeah.
not through yet.
So it would struggle
yeah.
in that
yeah,
environment.
Yeah,
so that's what we're kind of you know yeah. looking at. You know, just a completely different modus operandi.
Yeah.
You know, operational role.
So a rare opportunity here. We've actually bumped into flight crew here at Farnborough, which has been a real treat. And Owen, you work for Harpjet. Harpjet in the... excuse the noise. Anyone would have thought we were an air show with lots of things going on here. But you work for Harpjet, basically. You recently started. So how long have you actually been flight crew for?
I've been flying for maybe 3 weeks or so. Before that, it was 6 weeks of very intensive training. Well, that intensive training was on the beach in Malaga, Spain, which was beautiful, beautiful. So can't complain, really.
Yeah. So how does it start? So do you go for an interview, or is it sort of along those lines? Is it that you apply, or what happens?
Yeah, so you apply online, which is a very simple application process. There's a little bit of a kind of a questionnaire and a suitability test, just kind of seeing if you be right for the job, and also they ask you why you want to do the job, and then you get called for an interview. Big information day. There's an English written test and an English verbal test, and then you do a short interview, and that was it. I had to wait a few weeks, and then got the call to say I was hired.
You've already asked my next question, essentially. So why is it that's what you wanted to do? Why is it you wanted to become airline crew?
Oh, I just wanted to get into aviation, anything to fly, anything to be in the air. And yeah, it came up at a really good time for me. And I really, it's something that I want to do for a long time. And it's something that I really enjoy doing. So very glad I got the opportunity.
So you're air crew at the moment. What's the dream? Where would you like to go from there?
Oh, ideally, I'd love to be a pilot, but I think there are a lot of cabin crew who'd love to be pilots. But for now, I'm really, really happy just looking after people in the back and getting to interact with passengers. It's a really fun and very interesting job. Yeah.
I mean, I'm delighted in lots of ways because it's been a privilege to have you as part of our group during the our time here at Farnborough, but I'm very surprised that our resident pilots haven't put you off, to be brutally honest.
Oh, there's been plenty of stories and a few horror stories that they've been telling you over the last few days, but no, it's only fueled a passion.
Well, thank you for your time, Owen. We wish you the best of luck, and who knows, we might even see you on our next flight somewhere cool.
You never know. Thank you very much for having me, though. Thank you.
So you join me, Carlos, here in the media centre at Farnborough International Air Show 2016, and it's kind of a roundup sort of the week here that the APG guys have had here in the UK, and also their thoughts on the air show. So we'll start off with Dr. Steph. So from the beginning then, how's the week been for you?
It's been a great week, and really super thanks, first of all, to all of you guys over here for helping us out, helping us get here, helping organize a lot of this. There's a lot of people to mention, and I'm going to forget names, but they all know who they are, and we really, really appreciate that, and it's made just a really, really nice, really wonderful week, and it's been great from start to finish. So,
right, any highlights at all from the week that stand out for you?
Yeah, so the first part of the week, you know, we weren't, I wasn't here in Farnborough, but we went and kind of toured London and did that for a couple of days and went to Paris for a day, and that was all very nice and good and a little vacation to start off the week. So that'll always be a nice part of it. But certainly getting here and getting to meet everyone, I think that was that'll always be a big highlight of anything that we do, getting to meet people that you really just know from names, you know, like on the chat room, and that you may not know in person, and getting to really put those faces to the names, that's always going to be a big highlight, you know, above and beyond even just what's going on at the air show. All that's kind of, you know, certainly that's what we love and that's what we're passionate about, but kind of secondary to the community and the people who really came together to make this all happen for us. So
great. And then the air show itself, Steph, have you enjoyed yourself here over the last few days?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's been a really great air show. It's, you know, we were commenting on the way in today. It's like, this is not their first time putting this on. It's just such a well-run production and very well organized. And all of the flying displays have been great. You know, it's hard-pressed always to even pick a favorite because it's just fun to watch airplanes fly. So I'm not going to pick a favorite, but yesterday was great. We couldn't have asked for better weather yesterday, and it's actually cleared up pretty nicely today as well for some of these displays. And all of it's been really, really fantastic.
So last night, the big meetup at the Hog's Back, and that, do you enjoy that?
Of course, you know, it's always, again, super huge thanks to everyone who came out. That was by far our biggest meetup to date, and it was just a lot of fun to get to. It was really informal, and that was kind of the nice thing about it, was that we got to chat with everyone, and, you know, Al and I had a little eating competition that I won, but certainly go back and watch the show for that. But yeah, just the interaction between everyone and the live questions, that's always fun. You know, there's no way to prepare for that, and I wouldn't say that a whole lot of preparation happens for some of the questions that we get asked anyway sometime, but, you know, not to know what's coming and what's going to be asked, and that's always fun.
So any plans to come back to Farnborough possibly for the next show in 2018?
Well, I mean, we've got 2 years to plan it and make it happen, so I think it's not out of the realm of possibility.
Oh, great. So, moving over to, the man in charge, really, Jeff. You know, I mean, you are the guy who kind of brought us all together, really, to be honest. You know, you are kind of the father of aviation podcasts. So, how the week then, starting off the week for you, Jeff, how's it been?
Well, if I was responsible for all of this, I just want to apologize for all of that. No, starting off the week was great. Got picked up by the wonderful Neville Bounds from Heathrow, and had a nice stay over at his place, and went to a pub and did all the pub things that you do, especially for somebody like me who has never been over here. And we did the real ale and the fish and chips, and it was awesome. But, you know, we wanted to have the meetup here, and that, of course, Stuart Aslett, he's the one that kind of planted the seed for this whole thing. But when he came up with this idea, and we went, oh, yeah, so let's see, we got to have some excuse for somebody to actually come from long distances away for this meetup. So I wonder if there's like an air show in this area. And apparently there is, the Farnborough 2016 air show. So it was a grand time. The people here are just amazing. The countryside is beautiful. The weather has been, I think, for the most part, pretty nice. And what else can you say? It's been wonderful. And especially, you know, we've met through the internet, but not in person. And it's such a great thrill and pleasure and treat to meet. Oh, that's the F-35, right? To meet you, Carlos, and Matt. You guys did so much work in helping us put together this first-class recording before the meetup last night. And we really appreciate that.
I've got to ask, Jeff, real ales, come on, your first British real ale.
Okay, well, I think that they're wonderful. They're very authentic. And I think that I've developed a taste for the kind of the California style of very strong hoppy ales, and I haven't really yet experienced that kind of like in your face kind of a hoppiness that I'm used to, and maybe my taste buds are all out of whack or something, but I thought but they're very easy to drink. That's the thing I like about it. But in fact, I could go for one right now. I guess they're so good.
I think it is time for a beer, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm thirsty. But no, I love the real ales. I love how they, you know, they pulled the hand pumps out of the cask. No, not overly carbonated, not ice cold. Yeah, it just kind of really brings out the nice fruity esters and flavors of the beer. Awesome, really enjoyed it.
Great. So you've enjoyed the air show. You've enjoyed being here with us all, the group family meetup, I think. So yeah. Any thoughts for the future then, coming back to the UK at all? Any chance you might be popping back to see us in the next few years?
Honestly, it was such a terrible experience. I don't think I'll ever come back again. Sorry. No, yeah, of course. I don't know if we have any organized plans yet for, somebody was saying something about, you know, 2 years from now, back here. Who knows? We might be.
Or perhaps we can come over and see you guys.
Absolutely. I think next year we have a little shindig going on in the United States, over in Wisconsin, so that might be a great place to gather the group. My, that is a noisy jet, but it sounds great.
Can't compete with that, actually. Can't compete with that.
No.
No. So we are going to close things down then for this particular part of the show. So, well, on behalf of everyone here, I think, you know, thanks ever so much for you guys for coming over and you know, spending time with us over the last few days and over the course of the week.
It's been our pleasure.
Absolutely. Yeah, I couldn't be happier to be here.
And for those who don't know where they can find you, Jeff, come on.
The Yellow Pages. No. You can find us at airlinepilotguy.com. All one word, airlinepilotguy.com.
And there you have it. Thanks, everyone, for being here, and that's a wrap. So I hope you all enjoyed the amazing content there from Farnborough. We really enjoy producing it for all you guys and girls in the podcast world. And now, what a fantastic weekend. Let's hope to recreate that next year. Or in May in 2017 at Pittsburgh, hopefully, Matt. That'll be good.
Do you know, I thought you were going to say we'd go recreate it at Farnborough next year. I mean, that ain't going to happen.
No, know, well, Farnborough's not until 2018, so
no,
that
indeed.
Might be a struggle.
But if we do go this year, I mean, we'll get a great deal on a hotel, I think, as Jeff said in our Christmas show. It'll be great.
It's very
it'll
true,
be
it'll be brilliant. Yeah, there'll be no hassle traffic.
No cars,
no traffic. Yeah. Farnborough's definitely the place to go this year for the air show.
And you'll have just as much of chance of seeing the Airbus A3, whatever it was there as you would on the day. But anyway, there we are.
Oh, dear. But no, I hope you all enjoyed that footage, as I said.
Cool.
Obviously, look out for all the links on Facebook and Twitter. We'll put the links and bits and pieces to the show, and you can click on those and obviously find out when we're going to be going live in the new year.
Yeah, indeed. And if you're not familiar already, then make sure you find our various social media feeds. On Facebook, it's facebook.com/plaintalkinguk. Our Twitter handle is @plaintalkinguk. Our website, www.plaintalkinguk.com. And of course, if you want to get in contact with the show directly, it is podcast@plaintalkinguk. So that is where we wrap up our Farnborough footage. I hope you all enjoyed it. From me here in the caravan, it gives me great pleasure to say goodbye, and we'll see you next week for another live show.
And from me, Carlos, here in the PTUK kitchen studios, it's a happy new year to everyone, and take care. See you in 2017.
Bye.
Bye.